And you would have seen last night President Cyril Ramaphosa announcing in his address to the nation that he signed a proclamation authorising the Special Investigating Unit, the SIU, to investigate the misuse of COVID-19 funds. So the investigation would look into payments for goods and services that were not fair, competitive or transparent, and also look into whether these payments were facilitated unlawfully by employees or officials of state institutions or any other person or entity. So COVID-19 has also exposed the chronic failures in the country's health system. So this, as a report released by Corruption Watch this week, shows how corruption is one of the key reasons for the deterioration of the public health care system. Melusi Ncala, who is a researcher at Corruption Watch, joins me now live via Skype. A very good evening to you, Mr. Ncala. Thanks indeed for your time. So looking at this report, your investigation into corruption in the public health care system looked at the period between 2012 to 2019. It paints a troubling picture. Is what we're seeing now, a struggling sector at a critical time of COVID-19, the impact of years of fraud and corruption?
Good evening, Criselda, and good evening to the viewers out there. Yes, that's the short answer to your question, Criselda. Corruption is something that we've been asking to be taken quite seriously all this time. And if anything, the 700 whistleblower accounts that we received during this period indicate that we've basically are in a very, very troubling period. And no wonder then we are struggling to actually manage with the current situation.
Mm. Tell us a bit more about that report and the time frame of it. It was prior to COVID. I'll get to this particular period, perhaps, say, let's say, over the past 6 months. But the report prior to that, talk us through very briefly about what the picture was painted. What were some of the transgressions that were committed during that time?
So how we categorize the report of corruption that we received is that we received them based on employment corruption, procurement corruption, as well as the misappropriation of resources. These are 39%, 22%, and 16% respectively. So when we talk about employment corruption, we're talking about nepotism, favoritism, people claiming for work not done. These are professionals, doctors, nurses, also some high-ranking officials. And when we talk about procurement, we're talking about companies that are already doing business with the state or bidding to do business with the state, and they are offering to pay kickbacks in some instances up to 10%, and in other instances, they're encouraged to inflate their prices. Mm. So these are the matters that we are looking.
Mr. Ncala, you're yet to release a report pertaining to the same sector of your investigations, looking at the period from January this year to the end of June. What does the preliminary outlook entail? Because in that previous report, you speak about some instances that have also been picked up now, including price inflation, for example.
Yes, so around about this time of the year, we as Corruption Watch release what we call our Analysis of Corruption Trends Report. It's a half-yearly report in which we look at various forms of corruption through a number of sectors. And when we look at the health sector so far, the results are still troubling because the trend is that, you know, there's an upward trend basically in these reports. People are still complaining about the very same issues that they've had in the past 8 years. So people are still talking about employment corruption, that nepotism is rife. People are still talking about inflating of prices. There's some shocking cases coming through. So these are the issues that we're still looking at.
So that's over the past 6 months, Mr. Ncala. Let's just, that's from January to the end of June this year.
Yes.
All right. So, but I mean, is it not the lack of arrests and convictions that has made it easier for corruption to thrive even during this time?
Accountability is a key aspect that we cannot ignore when we talk about corruption. You know, it's good and well to have investigative structures, to have forensic reports detailing how corruption manifests in these various sectors. But at the end of the day, people want to see accountability. And that's what these whistleblowers are also saying.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, when they come to Corruption Watch, they come to us as a last resort.
Yeah. Mr. Ncala, just finally, so, I mean, can any faith then be put in the president, for example, signing the proclamation, authorising the SIU to look into the looting of funds since the start of the state of disaster, given what you're saying, that you're picking up the same trend of challenges pertaining to a reporting of corruption between January and the end of June? Should any faith be placed in this?
The intention is good. You know, we can always applaud the fact that people want to do something about it, especially at that level of government, the executive. But with that said, let us see results. Let us see people being held accountable. Where people should be prosecuted, let us see that, because that's what ultimately what's going to give us confidence in the system.
Mr. Ncala, thank you very much indeed for your time. Melusi Ncala, who is a researcher at Corruption Watch, thank you very much indeed for joining us via Skype.